Good afternoon, everybody. Wonderful to see you all here again. And some people I haven't seen for a while, and wonderful to see you here again at Fountain in the City. It's beautiful. What are we looking for? So just a couple of thoughts. It's not going to be a long sermon. If it is, it's your fault because you're... Yeah, okay. All right. Let's start. Okay. Just some searches. I could find only data on 2017. When you look at the list, the trend top 10 searches seem to be mainly centered on current events and what's happening around the world and what is in the news. That's basically what it does do. If you look at the 10 top searches, YouTube, I can understand that, Facebook, Amazon, Gmail, Google, Craigslist, eBay, Netflix, Walmart, Google Maps. These are the searches that we normally make. What is interesting about this one is what we're not searching for. Are you getting me? What are we not searching for? And I'll tell you what, 3.5 billion searches per day, that is 40,000 a second, and God isn't even in the top 10. Top 100, I'm sorry. Isn't that amazing? The search engines we use, we don't do anything religious. It seems to be completely absent. That really tells you a lot. When you look at this, isn't it fascinating? Sometimes I look at these statistics, and I like statistics because it tells you the trend and what is happening around us. But here's a very interesting one. If you start here from, say, about 17 years ago, or even 1999 or 2000, from where we are now, that's roughly around there, that is 1.6 trillion searches. Hasn't the world changed? And that's only in 18 years. I find that fascinating. When I looked at that graph, I know there's a huge increase in world populations, but there also is a huge increase in what we do and what we use, isn't it? We are living in a very rapidly changing society. It's very hard to get a handle on it, the directions where we're going. It seems to outpace us, maybe because I'm over 50, maybe that's why I feel that way, but basically, okay. Lifeway Research was commissioned to do this survey, and how much have you read the Bible? When you look at that, so none of it, just a few sentences, several passages, you know, in a lifetime, at least half of it, they probably lie, almost all of it, all of it more than once. That's only 9%. It would seem that the Bible is not playing, that's an understatement here, that the Bible is not playing a central role in the life of people in general. Are you with me on this one? We've got to be aware of that. Because you and I are coming to the end of time. We are in the end time, but there is a time when the time will end. That's the thing. The Barna Group was commissioned by the research commissioned by the American Bible Society, 2016, it's 2 years old. The majority of teenagers in the United States, sorry, it's only Yankee stuff, America is a little bit more religious than we are, and we are a little bit more religious than they are in Europe. Europe, it's almost a thing of the past. It's incredible. The majority of teenagers in the United States still have a reference to the Bible, and I think that's nice. But their views, and this is the interesting part, their views about what it actually means to them has evidently been influenced by many of today's secular influences. They see the Bible in a different light as did the previous generation. And much of it has to do with the authority of the Bible. I can tell you that. No doubt about it. That they have been subjected to via either public schools, the media, and the entertainment industry. Our educational institutions, unless they're overly owned by a church, obviously presents a very secular view, diminishing the validity, the veracity of the Bible itself and its values. We know that. That's true here, and it's true at any university just about. A solid majority, 69, almost 70%, personally own the Bible. Now that can be a hard copy, that can be, of course, on your phone, soft copy, etc. 43% of teens read the Bible at least 3 or 4 times a year. That's not very often, would you say? You cannot build up a knowledge on 3 or 4 times a year. Do you? What, so you know what the next generation, even from this, you know what the next generation is going to look like. And so 25%, a quarter, said they read the Bible at least once a week. That's not bad. Those are the good ones. That includes the 3% who do daily Bible reading. There are those who still do, and that is good. 11% report reading scripture several times a week. It's interesting when we come to the duration in a minute. 11% who read it once a week. The percentage of American adolescents who read the Bible less frequently is slightly lower. And so it says here 10% read the Bible once a month, 10% reports reading the Bible 3 or 4 times a year, 37% say they never read the Bible. Of the atheists and agnostics, 67% never read a Bible, and the only one that would do that would be the agnostics, not really the atheist. Time spent in God's Word in one sitting. Now have a look at this. 31% of people spend less than 15 minutes reading the Bible. 15 minutes is not very long, would you say? Not at all. Okay. 36%, about up to half an hour. Well, it gets better. 22% up to 3/4 hour. 10%, 3/4 hour or more reading the Bible. It's very tempting, you know, to have a show of hands, and I don't. But really, the reality is, how much time? Now, consider what we do all the other time. How much do you watch television? You know the answer to that. Does it equal or does it exceed the time you spend in the Word? Your planning, your work, whatever else, your leisure, whatever else. How much time, how much of your time does God get? Do you understand what I'm saying? We are so busy. There's all sorts of other things. We really are. The main motivations for reading the Bible, 54% says they read scripture because it brings them closer to God. That's the ones that read it, by the way. 12% it's an obligation, knowing, you know, you're supposed to. 8% for comfort when they really need it. 6% when they have a problem or need direction. Very low figures, isn't it? None of them desire to really do it. 10% for school, 11% says they read for some other reason, whatever that might be. God's literal or inspired word. 16% believes that the Bible is the inspired word of God. This is a couple of years ago in America. Here it's lower, Europe is even worse. 19% says it's just another book of teaching written by men. Now you hear that a lot. The Bible is written by? Just another book. The Bible is not inspired, 7%, 9% outright not. Say 9% say none of the options represent their belief about the Bible, and that doesn't make up 100%. I don't know what happened to the remainder. Should the Bible have a greater influence on society? Protestants, 86%, practicing Catholics, 54%, say this. Believe the Bible has too little influence on society. Non-practicing Christians, now that is a misnomer. That's a contradiction of terms, by the way. You cannot be a non-practicing Christian. Do you understand where I'm coming from? I don't even understand the term. But they say the Bible has just the right amount of influence. Atheists and agnostics obviously predictably say far too much influence. It's interesting, isn't it? John Barth is a postmodernist, and he is a metaphysical writer. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxies. Has anybody read that book? Yeah. That's him. He wrote that. No, he wrote that. Huh? Sorry? Okay, then the Wikipedia is wrong about that one. Yeah.
He died a few years ago.
He's in his late 80s. That's the guy. Check that one.
Oh, no, I don't.
Okay. All right. Well, it's interesting. I got this from Wikipedia. All right, we'll check that. Can't always trust it. He wrote quite a few other books that are really sold quite well. The Bible is not man's word about God. I like this statement. But God's word about man. I quite like that. It places the authority of God over man. By grace through faith. So what are we looking for? We're looking for salvation, right? All of us, every one of us. If we were believing in hell, how many of you want to go to hell? Well, there is no hell. I understand that. But how many of you want to be lost? None. We're seeking salvation. And so if we, you know, what we find is determined by what we're looking for. Would you agree on that? Yeah. So by grace through faith. For by grace you have been saved through faith. So the grace, it's not within your capacity. Even the faith is not really of yourselves. And that makes it a very interesting scenario. The faith that is needed to accept his grace is not your faith. It is the faith of Jesus who imparts it to you, if you let him. Do you understand the significance of this statement? Okay. It is the gift of God that is the grace and the faith. So, it's not of works. You know, I hear people say so often, we Seventh Day Adventists are legalist. You've been told you're a legalist? You're a legalist because you keep a seventh day Sabbath. Always ask the question, this is other Christians, do you keep any of the other commandments? Do you keep commandment number one? What is commandment number one? You shall have no other gods. Do you keep that? Number two, no graven images. That leaves the Catholics out. Number three, use his name in vain. And then you take the last six. I don't think that anybody's going to disagree on that. You should keep those. It's good for people. What prompts you to keep the other nine? And if you get a good Christian, he'll say, because of my love for God. And I said, that's exactly the reason why I keep a fourth commandment. Get it? It's no different. It's no different. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. We haven't anything to boast on this. Okay. By grace through faith. So then faith comes by the hearing. Now we would say today by the reading. Yeah? Yeah. People in those days, they would go to a synagogue. If they wanted to hear the word of God, they go to the synagogue because that's where they're at the scriptures. You have your own hard copy of the Bible, maybe various. And if you don't have the hard copies, you've got them on your little phone, your smartphone, and it's wonderful. The accessibility. So faith comes by the hearing or the reading, and by the hearing or the reading by the word of God. Why is that true? You can't be blessed if you don't give him your time. You can't. There is no shortcut. You must go to the word and seriously give him the time that he speaks to you through his word. Get it? You with me? Okay, very good. I like what Peter wrote about prophecies. You know, to me, when I discovered the prophecies of the Bible proper, Daniel, Revelation, and others, and I can see all the prophets, and I know they are written well before they occur. I have never seen anybody work out the statistical probability of the impossibility of this being coincidence. It is impossible for a document like that not to be inspired and have all these prophecies that account for history as we know it in its sequential order, the right eschatology, the right order. The details are fantastic. So, for prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved. How were they moved? By the Holy Spirit. And the evidence is in the fact that you can take prophecies, predictive prophecies we're talking about, and you can superimpose the written word on the recorded realities of the history as we know it. You know, you could never explain that away as a coincidence. It would well exceed that probability. The Sadducees. We talked about it at 2:00, and I want to talk to you about the Sadducees. Sadducees, we don't really know when they started. I don't even know what the word Sadducees is. The etymology of that word is very hard to discover, so I've given up. They were a small group of people, much smaller in number than the Pharisees. They were the upper class members of the Sanhedrin. They were the rulers. They were the rulers of course, Israel, but that's obviously they were under the Romans. Now, what happened with these people? They disappeared 70 AD when the temple was destroyed. They just disappeared from history. And there's a good reason for that. The Sadducees were business people. I want to talk a little bit about them. Business came first. And the main business was in selling the animals for sacrifice and the money exchange at the temple. You could only buy an animal for sacrifice with what? Temple currency. Yeah? Temple currency. Now, you remember Jesus, what he did early in his ministry when he came to the temple? What did he do? Oh, boy. You think he was hated by them? And then we're going to look at it. He did it at the close, the Tuesday before the Friday he was crucified. He did it again. They didn't like him. They believed in only the books of Moses. So they accepted the first five books. Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, and Deuteronomy. Not the book of Job, which is interesting. I want to come back to that in a minute. In those first five books of the Bible, there is no explicit explanation of a resurrection, which is what they don't believe in. It's implicit. And Jesus used that beautifully. So they don't believe in the resurrection. When you die, that's it. They are rationalists. People who say, unless I can reason it, visualize it, eyeball it, I don't believe it. This is the craziest statement that you could make, because it will absolutely do nothing towards the answer of where do I come from, what am I doing here, and where I'm going. But particularly the first. How do we get here? How can you be a rationalist living on this planet with a thin layer of atmosphere somewhere in a solar system, which is part of a Milky Way, or where we cannot discover any other planets at this stage that are inhabited? The nearest solar system is 4.3 light years away. How can you say that this is a coincidence of occurrences, and here we are, that's all we are? I don't know how these guys tried to explain themselves. Now, they believed in God. They did believe in God, but God did not really bother. They were almost like deists. God puts it there and then leaves it to your own device. They didn't believe in a soul, not as some of the others would, as an additional part of your makeup that then goes on living. No, they didn't believe that. So what they believed, you died, that's it. No answerability. Grab what you can what you get, and then sit on the lid. Greed. They were indifferent, disliked by the people. There was no compassion with them. They were very strict on the Mosaic law in the first five books. We'll come back to them. This is Jesus. He cleansed the second time. He did it again, didn't he? And that, of course, is economically speaking very damaging for their trade. They didn't like him for that. So the next day, they confronted him, but in a very sly, underhanded way, and I'll come back to that. What is also interesting about these guys is this. A few weeks before this encounter with the Sadducees and Jesus, a few weeks before that, less maybe 12 days, there is the resurrection of Lazarus. You familiar with the story of Lazarus? Eleazar, his name means help by God, because you don't come out of a grave by yourself. So Jesus, on the fourth day, mind you, on the fourth day, that is excluding any belief that he might have somehow come back to life by himself. The Jews believed that when you're dead, and they made sure he's dead, after 3 days there is no possibility of coming back to life. There's another belief that they had, which is very interesting, and it was held relatively wide. They believed that when you died, they believed there would be a resurrection, but at the resurrection you come out of the grave as you went in. So if you were an elderly person, like some, you would come out an elderly person. If you were young, you'd come out a young person. And so you would slowly upgrade to more perfection. It's crazy, some of the beliefs that they had. But here we have a people who don't believe in anything like that. They don't believe in angels. They don't believe in spirits. They're certainly anti-Trinitarian. They could never accept God the Son. And they certainly did not even accept God the Spirit. That was all hocus-pocus to them. It wasn't true. Now they have a resurrection happening on their own turf, very near, Bethany, it's only a couple of miles. You'd think they might change their mind. I mean, this man came back to life on the fourth day. That was remarkable. No, it didn't impress them. In fact, if anything, we know they wanted to kill Jesus for doing it, and they wanted to also kill off the evidence, Lazarus himself. Because it drew the people away, you see. The same day, the Sadducees, who say there is no resurrection, came to him, asked him. The same day refers to a further encounters with the Pharisees. There was an encounter afterwards. You read the 22nd chapter. It's quite fascinating. The same day, the Sadducees, who say there is no resurrection, came to him, asked him, saying, "Teacher, Moses said..." Now, this is interesting. Moses said. See, they're disciples of Moses. They're not disciples of God, they're disciples of Moses. You know how they venerated just about Abram on an equality part with God, just about. Well, Moses was to them that sort of a person. Anything that Moses taught. If a man dies having no children, his brother shall marry his wife. That is called a Levirate marriage. And you find that defended in Deuteronomy. It was implemented. It was given for a good reason. The brother, if he was single, would marry his sister-in-law, who became a widow, and raise up offspring on behalf of his brother who had died, because then the child would inherit the land. Do you understand? You remember the book of Ruth? based on that, Levirate marriage. Boaz was willing. A closer relative was not. Let me story what would happen to you. Now suppose you didn't like your sister-in-law. Suppose, could happen. And so you didn't want to do it. She takes you to court. Where is the court? The court is in the gate. You go to the gate, just like where Boaz went. And so you go to the gate and she speaks to the elders, the judges for the township, town. And they'd call him. You'd have to appear. And they would question you. You're not willing to marry her? Raise up offspring for your brother who passed away? And if you insisted, no, don't like her, don't want it. She had the right to remove your sandal, spit in your face, and your reputation would be as the one who in the gate lost his sandal. Crazy. And that was one of the worst reputations you could have. Because it was a Levirate law. Get it? You with me? Okay. Now, I think you know the story, but it's a great story. Now, they were with us. They're saying that this is an actual occurrence. They're not saying, for example, no, they were with us. Yeah? Follow that? Seven brothers. You know where this is going. The first died after he had married and he no offspring. Okay. So left his wife to his brother, not as an item of inheritance, but obligation to raise up offspring so the land ownership could be preserved and she would be taken care of. Likewise, the second one also, and we're counting here, and the third, even to the seventh. If I was one of the seven brothers, say number five, number six, definitely by number seven, I would run. She's a lethal lady. How did they die? Something wrong with her cooking? I don't know. But that is what they reckon happened. Then ultimately, the woman also died. She died as well. Now look at this. Therefore, in the resurrection, whose wife of the seven will she be? Good one? It's a fair. Did you know they had asked the Pharisees who believed in the resurrection time and time again, and they always stood there glowing because they couldn't give them an answer. And they would say, why don't you answer that? Huh? How do you explain that? Huh? They couldn't do it. They were embarrassed by that question. It was one of their favorite questions, and they put it to Jesus. I mean, after all, he had been a pain to them. He had disturbed their trade, you know, the very lucrative trade, and that's not the first time. And they didn't like him because he taught all sorts of things, including, of course, the resurrection. They all had her. The question here is a logical absurdity. Remember that term. A logical absurdity. That's what it is. So Jesus answered and said to them, here is the answer. It's brilliant. You are mistaken. It's very strong in the Greek. You're dead wrong. You're off the planet. You really don't know what you are talking about. Well, that didn't go down very well. Two reasons. You don't know the scriptures. Now, they prided themselves. They knew it inside out. And they could quote you. Not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God. These guys were rationalists. To come back from the dead with a new body. If you believe that, you'll believe anything, which is exactly what you and I believe. But then look what God can do. On a scale of difficulty, this is no problem for God. That's what Jesus is saying here. You don't know your Bible, so you're wrong. See, what are we looking for? What we are looking for determines what we find. It also determines how we interpret what we find. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's a very common problem. It's a very, very common problem. Nor the power of God, for in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage. Now, that may be good news for you, that may be bad news. I remember in the another church where Bosvioli and I were members, there was this old guy, an old Bruce, never got married. Had a lot of money, don't know how much, never found out. He had a lot of money. The one thing that he regretted about his life, he never got married. And he was looking forward to, on the other side, to finally get married, enjoy the marriage and everything that went with it. And I sat him down and said, Bruce, unfortunately, and I refer to this, he was devastated. He said, you sure? I said, well, have a look at it, Bruce. It's not going to happen. It's going to be really heaven for you, but no wife. I don't think he ever got over that. But anyway. And so there it says, nor given, because they will be like angels. Now, they're not going to become angels. They are like angels. Well, what do we know about angels? Let me ask you a question. How many angels since creation do you know from the Bible, I mean creation of the angels, how many of them have died? Yeah, none. There was war in heaven. You'd say there'd be some casualties in wars. We lose scores of people. But the interesting thing, none of them died. No, they didn't die. Angels are not a product of procreation. They are a product of creation. They don't have the capacity for procreation, meaning making babies. Get it? But we do. We die. And we supplement. In fact, we are increasing our world population, as we well know. By the way, the graph of world population, the way it goes up, it's fantastic. It's incredible. We've doubled world population in the last 40 years. What are we going to do if we do it again? And likely, as per scale, we should do it within 40 years. Think of the massive problems. Makes you wonder sometimes how long this world can carry on. Anyway, we will be like angels, and I could talk a lot about what it'd be like, perhaps. Some of it might be speculation, which is never fruitful, but the Bible certainly gives some information. We will have a society that is very superior than the society that we have today. Peace. Absolute peace. Never growing old, as in getting older. That's attractive. As you are seated here, we all wear these. You won't need them. You'll be covered in a garment of light. No washing, no ironing. No hanging out to washing. That's my job at home. And I do it very well as well, by the way. Now, where your preoccupation will be the well-being of every other single person, and their preoccupation will be your well-being. That is besides the fact you see God. You walk with Jesus sooner or later. There may be just the two of you. And so what are you going to say? Eh? Be marvelous. It'd be marvelous. It'll be wonderful. So, we cannot, the best of our life here on this planet is not a match of the most mundane moment in the afterlife, if you know what I mean. The exploration of our mind, The purpose. I always say that God has more plans for the life hereafter than he has for you right here and now today. Anyway. So you will be like angels of God in heaven. But concerning the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what was spoken to you by God saying, I am the God of Abram, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. I'm going to explain to you why that absolutely floored them. Absolutely did. And the God of Jacob. God is not the God of the dead. God is the God of the living. So it's interesting that when I look at this, and I used to, so if God is the God of Abram, Isaac and Jacob, and they've died respectively about some 1800 years, 1700 years, or just under 1600 years prior, so they have died, right? They have died. Jesus says, I'm the God of the living. God, his Father, is the God, and so is he. He's God. God is the God of the living. Then I might deduct that they are alive. I grew up in a church to believe that when you die, you either go to heaven or you go to... Right. Either way, you're alive. Because if you're in hell, well, you're out. Permanent. That's what I was brought up with. Frightened the daylight out of me. It always did. Fear is a terrible thing. I must have told you this story, and I'll do it again with the risk that you've heard it before. In winter, winters get very cold in Holland, and we had one heater in one room, so that was nice and warm. And so Mum would bring the pyjamas, and was only this high. And I remember putting those pyjamas. We had this beautiful stove, coal, you know, the heat, warms, lovely, lovely. And I remember putting my pyjamas on after having undressed, and I lost my balance, and somehow this part of my body and the stove had a very close encounter of the third kind. And I screamed the house down. My mom came out from the kitchen with a wet thing, and she put it on there, and then we put creams on. Oops, it's all gone. Now, you'll have to take my word for it, but it's all gone. It's all good. But there it was. And I thought to myself, if hell is anything like that, I better be good. And I was for about 10 days. And then it wore off. Okay. All right. God is the God of the living. So might it be, and I always believe that these good saints are with God in heaven. And then I meet this mob called the Seventh-day Adventists. And I learn about the state of the dead. And I learned about the resurrection, and I want to go on a little bit about it, with your permission, or without it. And then we'll see how I can reconcile what Jesus says here, who taught resurrection when he comes the second time. True? Okay. So, when the multitudes here, they were absolutely astonished at his teaching. They thought that was marvelous. They didn't like the Sadducees, and they loved it, seeing that Jesus absolutely floored them. Now, why did he floor them? This is the reason why. They believed in the first five books of the Bible, right? They believed in the books of Moses. Somehow they didn't get to the book of Job, and I'll come back to that. You remember that incident, the burning bush? Do you remember that? Okay. What did God say? He identified himself to Moses after ordering him to take his sandals off. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And this is about 1500 BC. So Abraham has died hundreds of years ago, a few hundred years ago, Isaac and Jacob. They're gone. They're dead. How can he say, I am? Now, in the Hebrew, the problem is that in the present tense of the verb to be doesn't exist. But here is the understanding of the Hebrew. If it was past time, it would say ani hayav. That would mean I used to be, I was the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. Implying now they're dead. Now they're dead, but to God they are not dead. Do you understand? So, and I'll prove it to you in a minute. That's exactly the way Jesus looked at it. So in the absence of the past tense, you can only imply, as it is correctly translated, in the present tense. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Now this is wonderful. Here is Isaac. I am the God of your father, Abraham. Do not fear, for I am with you. He was concerned in the locality where he dwelt, and he just went down back to Beersheba because he was worried about some of the other nations that were dwelling there, and God reassured him. So this is another time in the same book that they upheld. We go now to the book of Genesis even further, earlier. I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and of the God of Isaac. Now, who are we talking about? Can you see the picture? This is Jacob's ladder. Abraham had died, but Isaac is still alive. You with me? It makes no difference. He says, I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. Same thing. To God, the state of the dead is no obstacle. Do you understand? And that's how he uses it. In fact, if you go a bit earlier, the book of Job was most likely written before the book of Genesis. Tradition had it that Moses wrote it. So I don't know why I never found an explanation why the Sadducees did not go into the book. Though he slay me, yet I will trust him. Even so, I will defend my own ways before me. His friend said, you must have been very bad. That's why all these bad things happen. He said, no, I'm not. He's ready to defend himself, but he says to God, he kept his integrity, he will be my salvation. Now look at the next sentence in Job 19. For I know, he is certain, that my Redeemer lives. He's still there, despite what happened to me. And he shall stand at last on the earth. Now that is not a good translation, because this is in the connection with the resurrection. The resurrection finds place when Jesus returns. Everybody understands that? That's what the Bible teaches. But when Jesus returns, he does not stand on the earth. And that was put there by translators because this word, the acharon, that means at last, and at last, al on, afar means dust. That can mean the dust of the ground. It can mean your body. And so, Yakum is a purposeful arrival. He arrives with an intent and a purpose. Look at the better translation. He will arise at the last upon the dust. What dust? Let's look at the best translation. That he will act at the last upon the dust. What dust? Not the ground. My skin is destroyed, this I know. He talks about his body. He says, my skin is destroyed. His body is destroyed, you see. And then he comes, my Redeemer, and he acts on my dust. He's not standing on the earth. That was a mistranslation. Are you with me here? That is the best translation there is. And so he says, there will be a resurrection. Now the reason that they might have rejected the book of Job is the position that Job took on his resurrection. Get it? So they never mentioned him. In my flesh, he says, I shall see him whom I shall see for myself. My eye shall behold and not another. I'm not going to hear it from someone else. I will see him even if I'm put in the grave. Get it? Can only happen if you have a resurrection. And so, that's the book of Job. Resurrection, state of the dead, very important that we understand that. For if you believe Moses, he had said before, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But if you do not believe his writings, how are you going to believe my words? He's saying to them, if you're not going to believe Moses, how are you going to believe me? Moses wrote about me. And here it is, in Genesis 3:15, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall crush your head. And there it is in the Hebrew, I'll come back to that. And you shall crush his heel. Now it's interesting, I don't want to bother you too much with this foreign language, but that is really he, it can mean it. Yeshuvcha, that is in the present imperfect tense. Ros means head, it also means poison. In other words, what is the poison that's inside your head? Someone it was going to defeat him morally. Now the Jews will say, oh, that's us. No, it's not. They never defeated Satan morally, did they? Can't be then. Then you look at the next sentence, and it says here, and you, ve'ata, and there you have the teshuvcha, that's again an imperfect tense. Yakuv, that means crush. Yakuv, yakev, is the heel, and that is in the singular. If that is in the singular, then that must be in the singular too. It's nice when you look at the original language, and you see sometimes translations that are not quite correct. And it's good to pick them up. This is speaking about the one who was going to crush Satan, the poison that is in his head and what he stands for, and that's what he did. The Lord your God will raise up a prophet like me, Deuteronomy, like me from your midst, from your brethren, he'll be Jewish, and him you should hear, that's the word, Shema, you should hear him, you should listen to him, and that word also means to obey, Shema means to obey. This is in the imperative. This, you remember John the Baptist? The Pharisees, the priests came to him and they said, who are you? Are you the prophet? That's what they were referring to. Are you the prophet? He said, no, I'm not. Because that's the Messiah. You see, that's the Messiah. Our friend Lazarus sleeps. So Jesus was making his way, as I said, I go that I may wake him up. And they said, if he sleeps, let him sleep, he'll be fine. Then Jesus said, no, he's dead. But to Jesus, the death of Lazarus was asleep, as it is to all of his saints. You with me? He's still there, God. Your brother will rise again, he told Martha. And she said, yeah, I know he will rise again in the resurrection. And she said, at the last day. That is what she believed. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he what? And that is a certainty. That is an absolute certainty. Whoever lives and believes in me shall what? But yet you do. But not in his eyes. He brings you back. To him, you're not dead. You're there. The life force returns to God. The body goes back to the dust. Do you believe it? And she said, yes, I did. Remember this statement? Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. Do you like this one? This is a magnificent statement. Have a look at this. In my Father's house, we're going to perhaps finish with that. I don't know what the time is. I never, eh? Oh, time to quit. Okay, I'm going to finish with this text. Okay, have a look at this. In my Father's house are many mansions or dwelling places. Yeah? If it were not so, I would have told you. Why is he saying that? Why is he telling his disciples and you here today that in this Father's house, which is where? If he's going to have many dwelling places there, what's the interest to you if you don't ever go there? None. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, you could also say, he's also preparing us for the place. If you remember that as well. If I go to prepare a place, I will what? This is the second time. This is the second time. He's speaking, he's been there, he's there the first time. But he says, I'm going to back to heaven to prepare a place. Then I come back again. I come back again. Again, that's the second time. And I will what? Receive you to myself. Who is receiving who? Jesus is receiving you, isn't it? You are not receiving him that he comes to this earth and starts his kingdom for a millennium. No, 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 no. He doesn't say that. He says, I come and you come to me. The incredible reality is penned by the Apostle Paul. He says, we will meet him. We will meet him where? In the air. He doesn't come here and put his feet on the ground a second time. Gravity will lose its power over us and we meet him in the air. That where I am, where is Jesus now? Heaven. That where I am, there you may be also. The doctrine of immortality flies in the face of this text. Because if you're good, I like to think that's all of you, you die, you go to heaven. Why would he come back for you if you're there already? Does that make sense to you? Not to me. Not to me. He's coming back. There's a sleep if you die before he returns. There's a sleep, but you're sleeping in. He knows you. He knows where the dust is, the life force, and he puts them both together like at creation. Magnificent, magnificent, with a resurrected body that will, that you don't know how well you will feel. Not yet. And then you meet him in the air with all the other saints. Beautiful, isn't it? That's love, isn't it? That is love. May God bless you. Do we have a special item? Somebody puts their hand up. Yeah. Okay.
I love you, I love you. My heart is filled with praise. There's no one like you. God bless you.